You are listening to Second Chance Ministry Radio.
You are listening to Christian Audio's production of Spiritual Warfare, a biblical and balanced perspective by Brian Borgman and Rob Ventura. This book is read by Bob Sauer. One side of the horse or the other. Living the Christian life is not merely about mastering one truth or even a set of principles. Rather, it is learning to think and act biblically. We must be reminded of certain truths frequently so that we don't become unbalanced or myopic in our view of the Christian life. One such truth is that we are in a war of the most serious nature, and that war is not with flesh and blood, but against spiritual forces of darkness. This vital truth ought to shape our worldview. Unfortunately, some Christians almost completely ignore the reality of this war. Others, however, seem to give it far more attention than Scripture does. There is certainly a danger in both extremes. C.S. Lewis makes precisely this point in his famous work, The Screwtape Letters. There are two equal and opposite errors into which our race can fall about the devils. One is to disbelieve in their existence. The other is to believe and to feel an excessive and unhealthy interest in them. They themselves are equally pleased by both errors and hail a materialist or a magician with the same delight. Making a similar observation, Martin Luther once noted that Christians are often like a drunk trying to get on his horse. First, the drunk falls off one side, only to climb back up and fall off the other side. Given the stakes in this war, we cannot afford to fall off either side. The two extremes. Since the 18th century Enlightenment, the worldview of the West has grown increasingly closed to the supernatural. Consequently, many people today deny a world that God governs in which the devil and his demons are our enemies. This worldview is called naturalism. In this view, everything has a natural cause, and nothing exists beyond what we can see with our eyes. The biblical worldview, however, clashes with naturalism and not only embraces a sovereign God who rules over his world and the events of our lives, but also acknowledges Satan and demons. As Christians, we might have a biblical worldview in certain areas, but perhaps our perspective is more naturalistic than we realize. When we adopt this perspective, we view the universe as closed and leave little room for the supernatural. Although we may give credence to God's providence, the spiritual and supernatural do not factor in much in the way we view everyday life. In contrast, proponents of the other extreme treat spiritual warfare as the lens through which they perceive everything. Those who hold this view attribute virtually everything that happens to demonic activity and spiritual warfare. This worldview is built more upon fictional books and movies than the Bible. David Paulison notes, "A great deal of fiction, superstition, fantasy, nonsense, nuttiness, and downright heresy flourishes in the church under the guise of spiritual warfare in our time. Some false teachings include demon-possessed Christians, formulas for exorcisms, binding the devil, rebuking demons, and mapping their physical location. Many of these ideas have little or no biblical foundation. In fact, in the central New Testament passage on spiritual warfare, Ephesians 6, 10-20, the Apostle Paul makes no mention of any of these things. What they all lack is solid scriptural footing. And while many people throughout the ages have attempted to build doctrinal skyscrapers on such chicken coop foundations, these structures inevitably fall under their own weight. Their end is like that of the man who builds his house upon the sand, only to have it destroyed by rain, floods, and wind." Matthew 7:25-27. The personal ramifications are tragic. Doctrinal excesses like those just described often lead to an imbalance in the Christian life that magnifies one aspect of biblical truth to the minimization or exclusion of the rest of Scripture. These imbalances often result in the eclipsing or ignoring of such biblical truths as the believer's responsibility for his or her own actions, remaining sin in the Christian, the character-changing power of the Spirit, and the centrality of the gospel. The danger here is not that we might neglect spiritual warfare, but that we develop a truncated view of the Christian life in which we wrongly blame Satan and demons for every problem we face. If we are to live sound and stable lives as believers, then we desperately need a biblically balanced understanding of spiritual realities and the spiritual warfare to which God calls us. Anything else will be disastrous. The Biblical History of Spiritual Warfare. Spiritual warfare has existed from the beginning of human history. The events leading to the fall of Adam in the garden were the inception of the battle. Satan twisted God's word, challenged his authority, and lied to our first parents. After the fall, God promised continued warfare and ultimate victory. God said to the serpent, "And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel." Genesis 3:15. The struggle between the serpent and the woman would continue with their seed. Finally, the serpent would have a bruised head, a fatal blow, and the seed of the woman would have a bruised heel, an injury, but not permanently. Theologians call this the proto-evangelion, the first gospel. The seed of the woman is ultimately Jesus Christ. Although there would be a battle between those who follow Satan, such as Cain, and those who follow God, such as Abel, 1 John 3, 10-12, and there would be a battle between Satan and those who follow Jesus, 1 Peter 5:8, Revelation 12, 6-17, the ultimate battle would be between Satan and Christ, Revelation 12, 1-5. Part of Christ's mission when he came to earth was to overthrow the work of the kingdom of darkness. But Jesus knew their thoughts and said to them, "Every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and every city or house divided against itself will not stand. If Satan casts out Satan, he is divided against himself. How then will his kingdom stand? And if I cast out demons by Beelzebub, by whom do your sons cast them out? Therefore they shall be your judges. But if I cast out demons by the Spirit of God, surely the kingdom of God has come upon you. Or how can one enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods, unless he first binds the strong man, and then he will plunder his house?" Matthew 12, 25-29. Every time Jesus cast out a demon, healed the sick, or raised the dead, he was assaulting the kingdom of darkness. Jesus was entering the strong man's house, binding him with his superior strength, and plundering his stolen property. We see this, for example, when he freed the woman who had a demonically induced disability for 18 years. The synagogue ruler objected to the healing since it was on the Sabbath. However, Jesus responded, "Ought not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan has bound, think of it, for 18 years, be loosed from this bond on the Sabbath?" Luke 13:16. Jesus' ultimate overthrow of Satan, however, took place at the cross. Certainly the work of Jesus on the cross is multifaceted. There are so many dimensions to his redemptive work that we cannot narrow it to one truth. However, one aspect that we cannot overlook is that, at the cross, Jesus was stripping Satan of his power and performing the ultimate rescue operation. "Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven saying, "I have both glorified it and will glorify it again." Therefore the people who stood by and heard it said that it had thundered. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered and said, "This voice did not come because of me, but for your sake. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out." John 12, 27-31. The cross was an act of judgment, evicting the ruler of this world. Years later, the Apostle John would reflect on the incarnation and death of Jesus with these words, "For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil." 1 John 3:8. According to John, this means that part of our salvation experience is deliverance from Satan's power and kingdom. Having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. Colossians 2:15. Inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is, the devil, and release those who, through fear of death, were all their lifetime subject to bondage. Hebrews 2:14 and 15. Now, as followers of Jesus, we live in the tension of the already and the not yet, a subject we will discuss in detail in chapter 2. That is, We have been delivered from Satan's dominion through the finished work of Christ, yet we still battle. Part of our struggle in this life is that we must fight against Satan and his forces in the world. One day our victory in Christ will be fully realized. The God of peace will crush Satan under your feet shortly, Romans 16:20. But until that time, we must keep in mind the following truth. We are wrestling not against human beings but spiritual powers, Ephesians 6:12. Scripture commands us, therefore, to be alert because our enemy, the devil, is seeking to devour us, 1 Peter 5:8. How we think about this battle is critical to how we fight it. We cannot emphasize enough the significance of Ephesians 6:10-20, which is the basis of this book. This classic passage gives us a biblical framework for spiritual warfare. On the one hand, it frees us from the misconception of a closed, naturalistic worldview that understates our spiritual battle. On the other hand, it provides us with a sane approach that avoids overstating it as well. This text gives us a perspective on spiritual warfare that can dramatically shape our daily lives, showing us how to engage rightly in this great war. Our approach in this book is straightforward. We will present what Paul says about fighting this fight in Ephesians 6:10-20. Along the way, we will explain each piece of armor and practically apply its truth to our lives. Our primary focus will not be Satan, but Christ, who is the victor over all. For reflection and discussion. 1. When we consider the subject of spiritual warfare, what are the two extremes we need to avoid? Why might we gravitate toward either of the extremes? 2. How have you fallen off the horse on one side or the other, as Martin Luther put it? What truths will keep you from falling off? 3. What do you find encouraging about the history of this spiritual war? 4. What area of your thinking or living was directly challenged by this history?
You are listening to Second Chance Ministry Radio.